People's Forum is a movement incubator. We are an educational and cultural center where grassroots organizations and individuals can connect and gather ideas for collective action. Before we open the night, I want to acknowledge first the amazing organizations that helped to put this event together. Brado New York, Mulheres da Resistencia No Exterior, Defend Democracy in Brazil Committee New York, Colectivo Humanas, and Colectivo Alerta New York. So tonight is a very special night because we are honoring a very special man. Tonight we are talking about Lula, one of the most popular presidents in Brazil. Lula was a union man, was a man that when he was president reduced poverty, was a man who fought for the most marginalized people in Brazil to have access to education. Yet tonight, Lula, a 74-year-old man, is right now sitting in jail. Why is this happening? Yet also, Jair Bolsonaro, a right-wing fascist, a man who has called for cops to just go into the favelas and kill with impunity, is right now the president of Brazil. So we will tackle these questions today. Why is this happening? And by the end of the night, hopefully you'll get out of this space knowing that Lula is a political prisoner. And knowing that this is not only a Brazilian issue. This is an issue that concerns us all, especially those of us who live in the United States. Thank you. So without further ado, let's hear from Lula's own words.
Estou acima da justiça. Se eu não acreditasse na justiça, eu não tinha feito um partido político. Eu tinha proposto uma revolução nesse país. Mas eu acredito na justiça. E eu, às vezes, tenho a impressão, e tenho a impressão porque eu sou um construtor de sonhos. Eu, há muito tempo atrás, eu sonhei que era possível governar esse país envolvendo milhões e milhões de pessoas pobres na economia, envolvendo milhões de pessoas nas universidades, criando milhões e milhões de empregos nesse país. Eu sonhei que era possível um metalúrgico sem diploma universidade cuidar mais da educação do que os diplomados e concursados que governaram esse país e cuidar da educação. Eu sonhei que era possível a gente diminuir a mortalidade infantil levando leite, feijão e arroz para que as crianças pudessem comer todo dia. Eu sonhei que era possível pegar os estudantes da periferia e colocá-los nas melhores universidades desse país para que a gente não tenha juízes e procuradores só da elite. Daqui a pouco nós vamos ter juízes e procuradores nascidos na favela de Heliópolis, nascidos em Itaquera, nascidos na periferia. Nós vamos ter muita gente do Sem Terra, do MTST, da CUT formado. Esse crime eu cometi. Eu cometi esse crime que eles não querem que eu cometa mais. É por conta desse crime que já tem uns 10 processos contra mim. E se for por esses crimes de colocar pobre na universidade, negro na universidade, pobre comer carne, pobre comprar carro, pobre viajar de avião, pobre fazer sua pequena agricultura, ser microempreendedor, ter sua casa própria. Se esse é o crime que eu cometi. Eu quero dizer, eu vou continuar sendo criminoso nesse país, porque vou fazer muito mais. Vou fazer muito mais. Companheiros, eu acho que tanto o TRF4 quanto o Moro, a Lava Jato e a Globo, elas têm um sonho de consumo. O sonho de consumo é que o golpe não terminou com a Dilma. O golpe só vai concluir quando eles conseguirem convencer que o Lula não possa ser candidato a presidente da República em 2018. Eles não querem, não é porque eu vou ser eleito, eles não querem que eu participe, apenas porque tem a possibilidade de cada um de nós se eleger. Eles não querem o Lula de volta, porque pobre, na cabeça deles, não pode ter direito. Pobre não pode comer carne de primeira, pobre não pode andar de avião, pobre não pode fazer universidade. Pobre nasceu, segundo a lógica dele, de comer e ter coisa de segunda categoria. Eles decretaram a minha prisão. E deixa eu contar uma coisa para vocês. Eu vou atender o mandato deles. Eu tive chance agora. Eu estava no Uruguai e as pessoas diziam assim para mim: Lula, você dá uma voltinha ali, é só atravessar a rua, finge que vai comprar um whiskyzinho, você está no Uruguai junto com o Pepe Mujica e vai embora e não volta mais de pedazinho político. De lá você pode ficar falando. Eu falei, eu não tenho mais idade. A minha idade é enfrentá-los de olho no olho. E eu vou enfrentá-los aceitando cumprir o mandato. Eu quero saber quantos dias eles vão pensar que estão me prendendo. E quanto mais dias eles me deixarem lá, mais Lula vai nascer nesse país e mais gente vai querer brigar nesse país. Porque a democracia não tem limite, não tem hora para a gente brigar. Eu vou lá na barba deles, para eles saberem que eu não tenho medo, para eles saberem que eu não vou correr e para eles saberem que eu vou provar a minha inocência.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. I'm Sonia Silva from Alerta New York City, a collective of activists that fights for Brazil's democracy and sovereignty. We denounce Lula's conviction without evidence and the proper process, due process of law. I'm here to present our first panel, Who is Lula? What is his legacy? Our first panelists for tonight are Barbara Weinstein, a professor at NYU of Latin American and Caribbean history on race, gender, labor, and political economy in the making of modern Brazil. Also, Stanley Gasek, the Director of Global Strategies at UFCW, a union labor lawyer, and he's been following Lula since the 1980s as a labor leader. Thank you, and I hope you enjoy.
Oh, you want help? They're going to switch over there. Let me see if I can take this off. Hey, good night, everybody. My name is Toya Mileno. I'm going to be moderating this panel, and I'm going to be very brief before we start the panel, because I think this is a panel about Lula's legacy. I just want to share a little bit of my story and how his legacy touched me, so you can have an idea of what this means for millions of people around the country in Brazil. I'm older than Brazil's recent democracy. I was 10 years old in 89 on the election for presidency. I grew up in the 90s and in a country where neoliberalism was extremely strong, where the United States culture was valued more than our own culture in Brazil. And in Lula's first term, in end of 2004, I started working for his government on a federal program for digital inclusion, bringing internet with free software to people all around the country. They would send me to places where people never had electricity, and I was bringing internet, democratizing information in Brazil, communication, which is a big deal in Brazil. And while I was doing that was a digital cultural project, so we were teaching people how to use digital media and internet to produce their own culture. So I was teaching people that, and they were teaching me my own culture. I was relearning what is Brazil, what is my history, and being proud of that. I was erecting my spine, I was being proud of who I am. And that's what Lula did for the whole country. They allowed all of us to erect our spine, to be sovereign, to lead ourselves. And this didn't touch me alone, it touched millions of people. And that's why this persecution against Lula. That's how he is powerful, and that's his legacy. This is my story, how much he touched me. And now I want to pass to our panelists so they can share more of his story and how powerful it is. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank the organizers, especially Natalia, but all the organizers of this event for organizing the event and for inviting me to speak at this event. I just want to say, as a kind of apology, that since I don't know most of the people in the audience, I don't know how much each of you knows. And so for some of you, I may be saying too many details. For some of you, I may be saying too few details, but hopefully I'll get somewhere in the middle and it'll be just about right. I want to just say, in terms of my own background and my own connection to Lula and the Workers' Party, the Partido dos Trabalhadores, that I am, of course, much older than Brazil's democracy, most recent version of democracy. And I started going to Brazil as a graduate student to do research in 1975-76. And my first time I really spent a full year in Brazil was 77-78. Which is exactly when you had the emergence of the metallurgical workers' militancy and strikes and protests that were very crucial in starting the process that led to the end of the military dictatorship in 1985. And I think Stan will talk about that in more detail. So I just want to say that one of the most moving experiences of my lifetime was going to a rally in 1982, so still 3 years before the dictatorship ended, when Lula was running for governor of São Paulo state. Some of you know that under the military dictatorship, all governors were indirectly elected, quote unquote. And so this was the first time since the early 60s that there were elections for governor. And the governor of São Paulo, of course, is an extremely important position in Brazilian politics and society. Lula did not win that election. I'll say a few words about that in a minute. But he was so impressive, and the turnout and the number of people wearing the little red Partido dos Trabalhadores star on their shirt, and many, many young people, some of whom had never had a chance to vote for president in their lifetime, turned out for this rally. And it gave me the hope that there was going to be a different Brazil. And people were so excited about it and so excited about voting. They kept on turning to me and said, because the big question then is, were you going to vote for the Workers' Party or for a kind of coalition of centrist to moderate centrist parties that were anti-dictatorship but were more conservative or more centrist than the Workers' Party? So they said, who are you going to vote for? Who are you going to vote for? I said, guys, I'm a gringa. I can't vote, at least not here. But they looked, that was very sad that I couldn't vote. No. Anyhow, I've never seen people more enthusiastic and a vote being more meaningful than it was at that moment. So let me say, first of all, that the Workers' Party, the Partido dos Trabalhadores, or the PT, was founded in 1980. So just as Brazil is gradually having its opening or abertura that began the transition out of the dictatorship, I want to emphasize that that the PT was really the only completely new party that was founded in this period, that all the other political parties were basically reboots, and some of them not much of a reboot, of previously existing political parties, including two parties that had been endorsed by the military regime, one an opposition party, the other one a pro-military party. And so if you were interested in thinking about a different way of doing politics, of having not only a party that had a more left perspective than the other political parties, a more pro-worker party, it was not only that, but it was a party that clearly in every single way was organized and structured to be different from previous parties. Now, clearly the core of the party, and from the very beginning, Lula is the guiding light of the party. And clearly the workers' movement, especially in the industrial suburbs of São Paulo, the ABC region of São Paulo, was the core of this sort of original movement to create this party. But I think it's very, very important to emphasize that it was not just the new unionism, as it was called, that created this party, and that Lula, though the most important leading figure, was not the only major figure in the party. It also, for example, incorporated most of the what would have been called the Catholic left or a liberation theology in that period, and many of the people who were important figures in the party came from the Catholic left. It incorporated a number of different new social movements, including the Black Consciousness Movement, feminist movements. So it included many, many key intellectuals and artists, and represented a certain kind of progressive middle-class culture that was emerging in Brazil's cities. If any of you have seen the movie Aquarius with Sonia Braga, the figure she plays in that movie is really representative of that progressive middle class. So the PT, while it was called the Workers' Party, the idea of the workers and the people who supported the workers was a much broader coalition than just the labor unions. On the other hand, during the early years of the party's existence, I would say basically from in the 1880s into 1880s, I'm a historian, I'm always a century off. So 1980s to 1990s. So one of my students is here and she knows it's true, I'm always getting the century wrong. From the 1980s into the 1990s, Workers' Party candidates struggled to get elected. And I think it was for a number of reasons. I think because there was this sort of sense that perhaps they were too radical to be electable. that this was a time, you know, we just had this 21-year dictatorship. Now we have to kind of, you know, get everything settled. And there was also a sense that if somebody like Lula got elected, either governor or president, that the military would come back into power. And that was a very real fear at the time, because Brazil had such an odd and gradual transition to democratic rule that the sense that the military could come back was looming over many people who might have otherwise wanted to vote for somebody more progressive who was breaking with the older way of doing politics in Brazil. But I think what we start to see in the 1990s is that Workers' Party candidates start having success, particularly at the level of mayoral elections and congressional elections, and the PT starts to be a real presence at various levels of democratic practice in Brazil and start pushing for reforms and for more democrat. They are the representatives of the Workers' Party were very important in the creation of the 1988 Constitution, which has many very important and democratic features. So that even well before Lula is elected president, and some of you know, he ran for president a number of times before he was successful, the PT, the Workers' Party, was having a significant impact on Brazilian politics, both pushing it to the left and bringing in issues that were of interest to people who were from the poorer sectors of Brazilian society. Lula himself is, of course, extremely unconventional politician. He was born in 1945 in the interior of the northeastern state of Pernambuco to a very poor family, the seventh of eight children. His family migrated to São Paulo in 1952. This was a massive migration of nordestinos, northeasterners, to southern, southeastern, and southern Brazil. It's in some ways a comparable migration to what we call the Great Migration in the United States of African Americans in the late 19th and early decades of the 20th century, moving from the south to industrializing cities in the north of the United States. This is a really incredibly important moment. Well, not a moment, it goes on for several decades, but a phase in the sort of transformation of urban life in Brazil. They migrated in 1952. His formal schooling, as was very typical of many nordestinos migrating to São Paulo, ended with the fourth grade. And he entered the workforce, again, as was very common, as a child, and eventually becomes a lathe and press operator in metallurgical factories. And I want to just note that becoming a lathe operator was a very big deal. It's a very skilled position. I won't talk much about it. I wrote a book about industrial training programs, partly about industrial training programs in Brazil, which a lot of people think sounds kind of boring. But in fact, it's a kind of program that transformed the lives of people like Lula. I think it was really unlikely he could have become a labor union leader and an important figure within the union movement if he had not been able to acquire the skill. And the program, Senai, in which he acquired the skill, had been created by industrialists with the hope that it would turn workers into cooperative employees and supporters of the industrial bourgeoisie. And at some point, the leaders of all four of the most militant metallurgical unions in Brazil had been trained by Senai. So I don't think it worked out exactly the way they became good workers, but not exactly in the way the way the industrial bourgeoisie expected. So again, Lula runs for president several times before he's elected, and actually overwhelmingly elected in 2002. If you look at a map of Brazil, with the exception of the small northeastern state of Alagoas, I think every single state, a majority of votes went to Lula in 2002. And I think the reason for that has a lot to do with the disappointments of the endless neoliberal reforms under his predecessor, Fernando Henrique Cardoso, which made certain improvements in terms of stability of the economy in Brazil, but where you continue to have very few people sharing in that economic stability, and where you had problems like rising crime rates, and Brazil continued to be the world champion in economic inequality. And so I think the fact that on the one hand, the economy seemed to be calmer, more stable, seemed to be doing reasonably well, and yet most people were not seeing any improvements in their daily lives, really opened the door for people to think about the possibility that now is the time for a Lula presidency and for the Workers' Party to become the dominant party in Brazilian politics. The other thing I will say is that Lula and kind of relented at some point and realized, well, now may also be the time for me to change my style, my self-presentation. He starts, he stops wearing the bonnet, the cap, and the t-shirts. He starts wearing suits and ties. Though I think you can see from the little clip you saw at the beginning that he continues to be a very earthy, very down-to-earth guy, no matter how he's dressed. And so, if I can just, I'm just trying to figure out how much time. I still have some time. About 5 minutes. Oh, thank you. And I think it's particularly important to look at the remarkable achievements that were made during Lula's second term, but also during his first term, but especially during his second term, which was a period of a strong, very strong economy in Brazil. But I want to be clear that there have been other periods of strong economic growth in Brazil that have not yielded improvements in the lives of the average Brazilian. So it's not simply that he was, it wasn't just good fortune that he happened to be president during a period of economic growth. And then, of course, part of the economic growth had to do with his own, the Workers' Party's strategies while he was in office. And this is a period in which we see, first of all, Brazil is not significantly affected by the worldwide recession. It's actually able to weather the recession relatively well. We see geographic distribution of growth, which is more equitable. Brazil not only has, in terms of social class, enormous inequalities, but also geographically enormous inequalities, with the Northeast much, much poorer than the Southeast and the South. It's also a period in which we see massive expansion of healthcare and education, and major infrastructure projects, some of them a little bit controversial, but still some of them very necessary for economic expansion. But the social accomplishments are what I really want to focus on in the few minutes left. So I think some of you have heard about the Bolsa Família, the grant to families for keeping their children in school. And this was something that had been tried on a very small scale by Lula's predecessor, but was now massively expanded during Lula's presidencies. Also, Fome Zero, Hunger Zero program. In general, the PT governments addressed the needs of the most impoverished, but not only the most impoverished. I think it's very important to emphasize that in fact, many of the people now who have positioned themselves as the middle class that's opposed to the Workers' Party are in the middle class because of the Workers' Party. He reduced the power of patronage networks. So for example, in the interior of the Northeast, it used to be if you weren't a buddy of the mayor, you were unlikely to be able to collect benefits, even if you were entitled to them. And they changed the system so that you didn't have to be the buddy of the mayor anymore to collect benefits. The minimum wage was tripled. Pensions are now available to people who work in the informal sector, who typically either had to work until they dropped or had to face extreme poverty when they could no longer work. Affirmative action programs, both in terms of government hiring and admission to the universities, were implemented. There was more distribution of land to indigenous communities and communities that identify themselves as descendants of slave communities.
there was even a decline in the crime rate, a significant decline. I found an article from The Economist in 2008 that said that that people might have to get rid of the stereotype of Brazil as a dangerous place. And so when, you know, one of the things that tells us is that there are many ways to deal with the problem of crime other than going into a favela and killing every young man you see. So, and finally, I just want to end by, I don't have time, so I was going to say a little bit about foreign policy, but I just want to end that when Lula left the presidency in 2010, beginning of 2011, when he was succeeded by Dilma Rousseff, Emir Sader, a longtime activist in the Workers' Party, wrote an article, and I just want to read a short quote from the article. The Rousseff government, Dilma's government, has inherited not just a country in much better shape than Lula did 8 years ago, but also a weakened, demoralized, and defeated right wing, both in its political sphere as well as in the media. That is the context in which the Rousseff government must be assessed, as well as the progress it will make and the problems it will face in the thousands of days to come. Sadly, clearly, Sader was not right about the right wing. We know that the right, indeed, I would argue that we have to always be aware that it's extremely unlikely that the right wing is going to go on permanent vacation. And I think other people will talk about how we got from there to where we are right now. But I just want to end by saying that when Lula left office, he had an approval rating of nearly 85%. And it took a lot of ideological work by the right, by the more conservative evangelical churches, the more conservative agriculturalists, the more conservative, I say, Bibles, beef, and what, bullets, and the more conservative people allied with the military, with the police forces. A lot of fear went into turning a very large portion of the Brazilian population against the Workers' Party. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Barbara. I'm going to pass the mic to Stan, and we're going to have questions later.
Okay. Obrigado. Thank you. Good evening. Boa noite, sisters and brothers, comrades, companheiros, companheiras. My name is Stanley Gasek. I am the I've been with my union a long time, but now I sort of come back to the international area to have the honor of being the senior advisor, probably because of my age, that's the right title, senior advisor for global strategies at the United Food and Commercial Workers International Union, proudly representing 1.3 million working women and men in the retail, wholesale, food manufacturing, processing, healthcare, and services industries. Peço desculpas de antemão, de que os brasileiros e brasileiras, né, presentes por falar em inglês em vez de português. Grande parte da plateia, eu acho que talvez não seja lusófono, também não quero estragar minha fala com esse sotaque puxado do gringo, mesmo com anos de convivência. I was just actually apologizing to the Brazilians here, Brazilian sisters and brothers, for speaking in English, in English rather than Portuguese, but maybe part is not Portuguese speaking, and also said I didn't want to spoil the talk. Was still, after many years of experience with Brazil, with my very, very perceptible accent. It's great to be on this panel with Barbara Weinstein, a superb Brazilianist, a historian. I've had the honor of knowing her for a number of years. It's great to see her again. It's also an honor to be in the company of all of you. And thanks to all the organizers for this very, very important occasion in this beautiful, beautiful space for progressive movements. I wish we had this in Washington, D.C. in the same way, the People's Forum. Also an honor to be with the other speakers who are going to be joining us, Dr. Valesca Teixeira Martins, Breno Altman, and of course, political prisoner too, Mimia Abu-Jamal. As Barbara was saying, as she noted, on October 27, 2002, Luis Inácio Lula da Silva, lathe operator, a metal worker, former president of the Metal Workers Union of São Bernardo do Campo, one of the founders of Brazil's largest national trade union, Central, Central Única dos Trabalhadores, Trabalhadoras, former president of the Partido dos Trabalhadores, former congressman representing the state of São Paulo, was elected president of the largest, the most strategic power in Latin America, the world's fifth largest nation in terms of population, among the 10 largest economies on the globe. Lula's mandate was unprecedented in contemporary Brazilian history, at least at that time. 52 million votes, representing 61% of the total in that second round. In October of 2006, he was reelected in the second round with nearly 61% of the vote as well. Barbara's mentioned this. Lula squared the circle. He actually defied the odds. He achieved financial stability, the trust of the financial markets when there was all this fear of many within capital markets that now there's going to be a radical shift. There's going to be a drastic drop of interest rates that disappointed a number of people on the left in the first year. But he knew what he was doing, and in developing that surplus, was able to be more robust in the next year in the first term of achieving economic growth, having more and more active macroeconomic policy, and reducing inequality all at the same time. And we know that when we look at the Lula and the Dilma years, of 40 million were brought out of poverty. Over 20 million formal sector jobs were created between 2003 and 2013, the end of the Lula administration going into the Dilma administration. Now consider the reality that the Brazilian press been reporting in the last week about the World Bank's finding that during the Temer administration, now going into the Bolsonaro administration, that actually there's been a surge in the number of poor of 7 million, and that there is an average of 2 million poor being added each year in Brazil, up to about 58 million. This is World Bank statistics. Much of the Lula legacy, in terms of success, expansion, and social inclusion programs such as Bolsa Família, which Barbara mentioned, was maintained after the election of Companheira Dilma Rousseff in 2010 and in 2014. In many ways, deepened, all the more effective in terms of linking labor intermediation all the more with the beneficiaries of the program. But all of this only to be followed for what was and is a parliamentary coup, which removed her from office on totally baseless, unsupported grounds, certainly in terms of the Brazilian Constitution's own definition of crimes of responsibility. The Senate expert report, the Senate, the body that actually had the fatal blow with regard to the impeachment process, the expert's report basically said that she had not even engaged in the so-called pedaladas, or the delayed reimbursement of the state banks by the Treasury for social programs. Now we face continuation of that coup with the advent of the Bolsonaro era, which ominously has symptoms of the unmistakably military coup of 1964, at least in terms of rhetoric, policies, and appointments. Consider what Bolsonaro just said about March 31st, that we're not celebrating, but we are memorializing the 55 years. And let us not forget Bolsonaro's vote in the Chamber of Deputies when he was federal deputy in April of 2016. I was there in Brazil to watch it, and he was praising Colonel Carlos Alberto Brilhante Ustra, torturer-in-chief during the military dictatorship and the torture of Dilma Rousseff. Luis Inácio Lula da Silva would unquestionably have been elected, would have been elected, had he had been allowed to have been a candidate. And the UN Committee on Human Rights, and I'm sure Dr. Valesca will be talking about this tonight, said that he should be a candidate, and that if he is not a candidate, his rights under the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights, which Brazil had ratified, therefore it's binding on Brazil, would be irreparably harmed. Of course, the Brazilian authorities, they thumb their nose at that. There is an incredible lack of coverage, I think, credible gap amongst elite media sources, elite circles in Washington following Latin America that I also come across. But the basic question really is not answered, is what caused this shift to authoritarian right-wing populism of Jair Bolsonaro. Very few people are explaining this. One, he's not particularly a left-wing commentator, political scientist, but a colleague, Matthias Spector, actually wrote something recently which said he took everything out of the Trump playbook. And for sure, because Steve Bannon was directly contracted by the campaign, and it was social media with corporate investment expenditures violating Brazilian law, criminal and electoral laws, but of course they're going to get by with impunity, a false moralism with a multiplier effect in the churches, particularly in the right wing evangelical churches, a false portrayal of him being an outsider and not part of the corrupt political elite, and his law and order message. Unfortunately, this had a certain effect with the working poor. The working poor are the victims of crime. And an appeal, in many ways, to paraphrase Abraham Lincoln, the campaign made the appeal to the lowest angels, not unlike Donald Trump's siren song to the US white male working class, including union members, unfortunately, in 2016. I have to realize that my time's moving very, very fast. So let me go to my point that I want to talk about. Barbara was saying that the Workers' Party was not exclusively a trade union party. It was unlike the formation of the Labour Party in Britain in terms of the origins. But Lula has always identified himself as a trade unionist and a union leader. And that is how I came to know him. I went through my own experience, my own epiphany. I have known Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva since February of 1981, when the late John Christensen of the United Auto Workers, when I was a much younger lawyer with the United Food and Commercial Workers, and the former secretary of the DGB, the German Trade Union Central, and a member of the German Parliament, West German Parlament at that time, we were the Comitiva, we were actually the Committee of Solidarity, when Lula was tried and very predictably convicted under the national security law because of the strike of 1980. He basically followed the will of the workers as a leader. They said, we want to stay out, keep on strike, going beyond the paltry, the compulsory arbitration decision that was made by the labor courts. But that was what Lula was convicted for, later acquitted. He had, this is a point I want to make, he had more ambulatory freedom then than he does now. Lula was always there for us. There have been a number of trade unionists who have been heads of state. Some of them have been good, some of them have been not so good. We have, of course, Stefan Löfgren, the Prime Minister of Sweden, is one. Bob Hawke in Australia was another. Lech Walesa in Poland was another, although he chided Lula, ironically, in 1980 before the Pope, saying, you shouldn't form a political party. Look what happened with Solidarność. And I have to admit it, even Ronald Reagan, once the president of the Screen Actors Guild, although that one didn't go so well, in terms of trade union rights in the United States. But Lula has been unique. I don't have time to go into every example. But before being president, during his presidency, and after, even in this unconscionable situation of being a political prisoner, he has been with the trade union movement. He has understood that it's a two-way street. He was there for us trying to organize bank workers in 1992, the Brazilian agencies, including here in New York, 1992. He convoked a press conference saying, isn't it amazing that the US unionists were there with me and European unionists, now it's my time to reciprocate. He was there with the United Steelworkers and their problems with Gerdau. He was with the UAW at Nissan and Renault in 2013, speaking to the United Auto Workers. And in November of 2016, when I saw and spoke with Lula at the Instituto Lula in Sao Paulo, I mentioned to him that our largest employer in the meatpacking sector is Brazilian. It's JBS Freeboy, and he says, if you ever have problems, let me know, because I will help. All of his trips to the United States as president, he made a point of seeing us. And as a matter of fact, I'll just mention this very, very quickly. In March of 2009, in the hour before he went to first meet President Barack Obama, He met with President John Sweeney. I had the honor of being in that meeting as well. He always made a point of that. Finally, I will conclude by just noting this. What Lula accomplished, what Dilma continued, well, it was not revolutionary. It was not a revolutionary program. It was not a radical socialist program. It was in great part Keynesian, New Deal inspired, and Lula read a lot about the New Deal. I knew that actually accompanying him on the Caravana in 1994. But it was, to paraphrase Michael Harrington in many ways, it was his attempting to achieve the left wing of the possible. The AFL-CIO has recognized these contributions. He's receiving the Meanie Kirkland Award, which is the highest award for human rights that the U.S. labor movement gives. This decision was made by the Executive Council last month. But even though what he accomplished or what Dilma accomplished was actually win-win for everybody, including for productive capital, including for financial capital, which really was unscathed, it really didn't challenge the relations, the class relations that much. It just brought more people in and drove the economy and made things more successful. But multinational elites, global capital, Brazilian capital, it still was too much for them. And that's what we're seeing. That's what we're seeing now. And I'm going to just leave with this comment, which I always love citing, which Lula made when he came. He made a triumphal appearance. He wasn't expecting such a big rally of 350 people in the lobby of the AFL-CIO when he was president-elect. And it was just after he had met George Bush. But he came to us. He said, "I'm feeling much more at home here." And he said the following to us. He said, "If I don't do well, you're not going to do well. You're going to have to help me succeed, because we all can't fail, because I don't know the next time that a lathe worker, that a metal worker, and that a trade unionist is going to be elected the president of Brazil." Sisters and brothers, companheiros and companheiras, I hope this event will be part of our movement to guarantee that there will be another Lula era. Thank you.
We're going to open for questions. We're going to do batches of three questions at a time. So I ask people who have questions to raise their hands, and we're going to pick three questions, and then the panelists are going to answer. So if anybody has questions, all right, have one, two, and three.
Hey. Okay. And if you want to speak in Portuguese, I can translate. So.
Se quiser falar em português, ela pode traduzir.
Could you please speak to the corruption charges that we continually hear in the Workers' Party?
Okay, and on terms of the cultural side, I believe there's no longer a Ministry of Culture. But under Lula, it was Gilberto Gil who was Minister of Culture, and the import of that.
A terceira daqui.
Boa noite. I think Barbara defined Lula as a guiding light. And throughout your dissertation and the chronological reasoning that you brought to the picture, maybe I'd like for you to elaborate how he continued to be a lighting guide today, not only for Brazil, but for the world. I don't know if I can have two questions, but that's a good start.
There are other people who I think are more equipped to talk about the corruption charge. I actually think what I'd like to talk about is an earlier corruption scandal, the Mensalão scandal, which directly involved the Workers' Party.
and which I have to say, frankly, I think was a bad calculation. And I think, but the motivation for it, different from other corruption scandals, which have been absolutely routine in Brazilian politics under the military, not under the military, is that it was not a scandal geared and on the part of the Workers' Party for personal enrichment. The people who were receiving the money, who were not from the Workers' Party, were motivated by personal enrichment. What was motivating people in the Workers' Party was getting legislation passed that they clearly felt would save thousands of people's lives and improve millions of people's lives. And there, because of the structure of Brazilian politics, which I think is one of the most crucial things that needs to be reformed, it is relatively easy to create a small party, to get a couple of seats in Congress, and then in effect say, I'm not going to vote for you unless your project, no matter how worthy that project might be, unless you pay me. And so it's in effect, it was embedded in the way Congress was operating. One of the things one could say is, well, you have to win more seats in Congress so you don't have to pay them. But under the current political structure, it's very difficult to do that. So I am not here to say that there has never been any corruption that involved the PT. I do think the charges against Dilma were completely spurious. They were just totally fabricated, in the sense that this was not only did she not do it, but this is completely standard practice in every administration, not just in Brazil, but everywhere. And that the charges against Lula also are spurious, that they have the evidence. I mean, to be imprisoned while before you've had the entire process finished, just to start with that, is ridiculous. But I'm not going to say that there hasn't been any corruption involving members of the PT. You can't say that and be honest about it. But I do think that it has not been motivated by the motivations that have characterized other scandals that have been swirling around related to Lava Jato, the car wash scandal, which is generally about personal enrichment. It's a very different kind of motivation. And that may not matter to certain judges, but it matters to me. And I think it matters to most people. So I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Yeah, I'm sure, I'm definitely sure that when Dr. Valeska joins the discussion, we're really going to be getting into the details of this. And I've been attempting to follow, being a lawyer by training, having some more familiarity with the labor justice system in Brazil than with the criminal justice system and constitutional system, although I have to say I've become a world of education, and actually exchanges directly with Dr. Valeska and Dr. Cristiano Martins about the whole process. I would echo what Barbara has said about corruption. Just a number of points. The PT did not invent corruption, although the whole conventional wisdom within the media and so forth was that, well, they were the auge, they've been the tops with regard to this. And no, these were the origins, even the origins of Mensalão were there in the Fernando Henrique Cardoso administration. And there were those who were actually practicing this as well, of having to get to the nano parties in order to try to get particular objectives. It's just that you did not have actually the public ministry and the prosecution, at least probably for political reasons, so supercharged to go after it. Actually, in many ways, thanks to Lula, what he did in terms of moving forward anti-corruption measures and strengthening the criminal justice system and the Ministério Público, is actually he invested actually in anti-corruption measures. But it is just, and regrettably, it's so much structurally part, and it's a part of the historical institutional. Part of Brazil. But there's no question, we're there to be. It's not going to eliminate everything. But if there were political reform, particularly with regard to this which becomes a very perverse system of open proportionality, particularly within the Chamber of Deputies, and actually stimulating the proliferation of nanoparties, there was basically the whole enabling environment for this. And I would agree with Barbara, what she said is that there were some of those who were, thinking of perhaps of Trotsky's famous essay, and had that basically of its, their morals and ours. Essentially, it is that we are in power now. We have limited power, and so the ends need to the ends will justify the means. But to say that there's even those who are have been imprisoned, been in detention, including former treasurers of the PT, including the very unfortunate case of Zadir Seo, who had been the minister of Casaville and a brilliant founder, theoretician, and politician. But even in their cases, there had been evidence, affidavits that had been totally ignored, which would actually go to their defense. And ironically, even though we look now a year, actually the anniversary now of Lula's detention, again, he may continue to face liability. But Zadir Seo, the STF, the Supreme Federal Court in Brazil, decided that given a certain probability on the merits, once his appeal goes up the food chain, he should be released on habeas corpus. That's what it should have been done in Lula's case. You have basically an airtight case. And again, we'll get into this later on, but just to conclude, consider this. Basically, the two sentences against Lula, which make up to about 25 years now, the first with regard to the supposed quid pro quo and corruption involving the condominium in Guarujá, the coast of Sao Paulo. You don't have to be a lawyer to see that the sentence that Sergio Moro rendered is a total contradiction. And I will repeat it, because it is just so absurd. He is being convicted of undetermined, what does undetermined mean? No proof. Official, what does official mean? Well, he's president. Now, this whole business about he's supposedly going to receive this apartment, this condominium, is something of value as a quid pro quo with regard to the OAS company that was involved in the kickback scheme in Petrobras. But no, it was all about he's supposedly going to occupy that property after he was president, and he never did that. And he never had title. He never owned it. I mean, the whole sentence, by the way, I'm just shorthanding, this other sentence that was brought by the other judge regarding a property in Atabaia in the interior of Sao Paulo, clearly not owned by him. It's unbelievable. Yeah, it was owned by the son of one of his best friends, Jacob Bittar, who's the president of the oil refinery workers of Campinas, and he didn't have title to it. Oh, well, but again, there must have been there was that quid pro quo, because there were reforms, improvements done on that property as it was done on the Guarujá property. Was never established, still has never been established, was that the, quote, dirty money actually went to those reforms. And again, we can go on and on about the details, but who has been seen as having, doing the singing in order to try to implicate criminally Lula is the infamous Leo Pinheiro, who's had been the head of the OAS construction company. But remember this, when he was giving the delações premiadas, the equivalent of plea bargaining, three times under interrogation, he said, Lula's not responsible. No, Lula's not directly responsible. Then facing 25 years, he said, well, I don't know. Maybe there might have been. And then therefore, Sergio Moro relies on that. The second sentence, by the way, is unbelievable. It is, and I'm sure Dr. Valesca will talk about it. The judge was so lazy that she cut and pasted parts of the former Sergio Moro sentence into that particular sentence. It actually uses the word condominium for the housing area, the Cunha there, which is not really not the right word to use in Portuguese, in Atabaia. It showed how lazy she was and how she was just cutting and pasting that first sentence. So with regard to Lula, there is nothing. And again, we'll go on and on about this, but Lula is innocent. This needs to be the discourse.
Yeah. I'm going to take more than 30 seconds. So first of all, just about Gilberto Gil having been Minister of Culture, I mean, one of the things about the situation in Brazil from then to now is the whiplash. That is, it is really hard to imagine. There have been many, Brazil is not the only country in the world right now that's experiencing a turn to the extreme right, but I think nowhere has the experience been so traumatizing as, you know, to go from having somebody like Gilberto Gil as your Minister of Culture and then having the Ministry of Culture stuck together back with the Ministry of Education, which is headed by, I won't even say what, but a complete fool. And he's worse than a fool. I mean, he is a fool, but also worse than a fool. So that's all I have to say about that. And then finally, just to say something quickly about Lula as continuing to be a sort of guiding light for, I think that, I mean, I always think it's important that a political party not be reduced to its leader. And I think that the Workers' Party has an importance and a significance in Brazil that isn't reducible to Lula. On the other hand, Lula is, in the history of Brazil, really a totally remarkable figure. And I just want to say, it's not that there have been no other important politicians in Brazil who came from poor families. There have actually been a number. But in order for them to have political success, they had to transform themselves into somebody from the middle or the upper class, in the way they presented themselves, in the way they talked, in the people they associated with, in what they advocated. You know, so Brazil's greatest novelist of all time, Machado de Assis, was the descendant of slaves. But in order to become a great novelist, he also had to become a man of letters, a man who associated only with sort of intellectual elites in Rio. So it's not that there hasn't been social mobility in Brazil. There has been, but it has required you to basically become part of, you know, classe A, the upper class. And the difference with Lula is that he has become a world-renowned political figure by remaining a man of the working class. And that is really what separates him from all the others.
Thank you, the panelists. Unfortunately, we're not going to have time for more questions, but at the end of the event, people can mingle and ask questions directly. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. We're going to break for 10 minutes to allow the band for setup, and then we're going to come back for a live performance by CISA. Please take this time, if you haven't seen the exposition, to see it, grab a snack. And just wanted to acknowledge that there's some swag being sold of Lula, and also a book by Lula himself if you want to go check it out. Thank you.
Hello, song, nice. Guitar's pretty, I don't hear my the guitar yet.
Yo, radio? Radio?
And I don't have my, nothing on the monitor yet.
Ei, som, ei. Ei, som, dois, ei, música, dois, teste. Ei, som, ei, ei, ei. Um, dois, som, ei, ei, som, teste, ei. Música, um, dois, ei, som. Ei, som, um, dois, ei, ah, ei, som, ei, é. Ei, som, um, dois, ei, é, ei. Ei, teste, um, dois, som, um, dois, ei, 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 ah. Som, ei, 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 ei,
pode baixar um pouquinho.
Fala espanhol. El mío, alô, som, tá. Ah, não, I don't hear a lot here. I don't hear myself or the guitar here. Som, okay, there it is. The guitar now. Guitar. Tatuagem.
Thank you.
você tanto. Com todas as cordas, notas felizes, com seu clamor. Você toca com delicadeza, cor de riqueza para se expor. Teu sorriso é mais belo que a fama, é um panorama. Can I have a little more guitar here?
Ela tem muito acorde. Ela tem é muito, ela é meio complicadinha. Não precisa fazer não. Então,
we're gonna do a little sound check. Bear with us, bear with us.
Hey!
Você canta com todas as notas, notas felizes, com seu clamor. Você toca com delicadeza, cor de riqueza para se expor. Teu sorriso é mais belo que a fama, é um panorama de consolação. Teu segredo é um livro aberto no meio deserto temporal. Me diz dos teus desejos mais profundos. Me diz dos teus segredos vagabundos. Ao pé do meu ouvido, onde faz mais sentido. Que quero soltar minhas asas contigo. Na cidade turbulenta, quem te escuta? Passarinho, passarinho, passarinho. Passarinho, musa, musa, música, musa, musa, música, musa, musa, música. We still need a little more guitar, my guitar up here, yeah. It's not coming through, I don't know. There we go. Is not on, guys. Vocês não estão ouvindo. Just the cajon now is what we need. Take down the mids a little bit. We're good. Okay, thank you guys so much for being patient with us. I'm so sorry about the delay. My name is Cissa Paz, and I'm here tonight with Fernando Sassi and Boca Melodia. Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm really happy to be here. I came up from DC for this event, and it's an honor to be here. I love Lula, and I don't think that Brazil's having a good fortune at the moment. This first song is actually, I'm going to talk about nature, and it's let's appreciate nature and how much we need to take care of it as well, so it can take care of us. Thank you. Thank you so much. The next song is a song I wrote for women. It's for us. It's for you. It's for our struggles and for our victories and for our strength and our weaknesses. And it's a samba, so help us out with a few claps. Chora, sempre se melhora. Teu canto rico revigora. Nessa nossa história, quem te vê dançar se enamora. Quando você se comemora, vem cá, me conta. Teus defeitos também são bem feitos. Respiro o ar de teu sonhar no ventre de nosso estar. Quero ver você brilhar, feminina eu quero ser. Oba lua é odara, oba lua é odara, oba lua é odara, oba lua é Deus dará.
From the top.
Woman, you sing, dance, you cry. You're always worth a try. Your sweet voice is a revival. The way our story goes, those who see you dance and fall in love. Your sweet moves are mystical. Come here and tell me all your faults. They are all so well thought out. In this dream there is no doubt. In the belly of divine, I want to see you shine. Feminine, I wanna be. Oba lua e odara. Oba lua e odara. Oba lua e odara. Oba lua e Deus dará. De novo. Oba lua e
goes,
beijo. You guys.
Baluaê, Deus dará. Odara, odara, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Odara, 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 yeah. Odara, 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 yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Odara, 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 yeah. Odara, odara, odara. 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 Odara, odara, odara.
Thank you so much. You guys sounded great. Odara means beautiful. All things beautiful. All things women. Can you mute me, my guitar? Now this one, the Brazilian people are gonna know, so I wanna hear you guys singing it, huh? Quem é brasileiro conhece essa música?
Manga rosa, eu quero gosto sum. Melão maduro, sapoti, joá. Jabuticaba, teu olhar noturno. Beijo travoso de um bucajá. Pele macia, carne de caju. Saliva doce, doce, mel, mel de uruçu. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vou te desfrutar. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vem me desfrutar. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor. Oi, 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 oi. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor. Olha da manga rosa, eu quero gosto sumo. Melão maduro, sapote, joá. Jabuticaba, teu olhar noturno. Beijo travoso de um bucajá. Pele macia, carne de caju. Saliva doce, doce, mel, mel de uruçu. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vem me desfrutar. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vou te desfrutar. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor. Oi, oi. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor. Oh, 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 oh. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor.
Oi, 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 oi.
Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor.
Oi, 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 oi.
Leva.
Da manga rosa eu quero gosto sumo. Melão maduro, sapote, joá. Jabuticaba, teu olhar noturno. Beijo travoso de um bucajá. Pele macia, carne de caju. Saliva doce, doce, mel, mel de uruçu. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vem me desfrutar. Linda morena, fruta de vez temporana. Caldo de cana caiana, vou te desfrutar. Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor.
Oi, 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 oi.
Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor.
Oi, 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 oi.
Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor. Vai! Morena tropicana, eu quero teu sabor.
Obrigada. Thank you. I think that we're running a little late, so we're going to do one more. Is that okay? A little sambinha for you.
mais voltar, pode até se acostumar. Ele vai viver sozinho, desaprendeu a dividir. Foi escolher o mal, me quer entre o amor de uma mulher e as certezas de um caminho. Ele não soube se entregar e agora vai ter de pagar com o coração. Olha lá, ele não é feliz, sempre diz que é do tipo cara valente. Mas vejam só, a gente sabe que esse humor é coisa de um rapaz que sem ter proteção foi se esconder atrás da cara de vilão. Então não faz assim, rapaz, não faz esse cartaz. A gente não cai não, ei, ele não é de nada. Olha essa cara amarrada, é só um jeito de viver na pior. Ele não é de nada. Olha essa cara amarrada, é só um jeito de viver nesse mundo de mágoa. Ele não é de nada, ele não é de nada. Não, ele não vai mais voltar, pode até se acostumar. Ele vai viver sozinho, desaprendeu a dividir. Foi escolher o mal, me quer entre o amor de uma mulher e as certezas de um caminho. Ele não soube se entregar e agora vai ter de pagar com o coração. Olha lá, ele não é feliz, sempre diz que é do tipo cara valente. Mas vejam só, a gente sabe que esse humor é coisa de um rapaz que sem ter proteção foi se esconder atrás da cara de vilão. Então não faz assim, rapaz, não faz esse cartaz. A gente não cai não, ele não é de nada. Olha essa cara amarrada, é só um jeito de viver na pior. Ele não é de nada. Olha essa cara amarrada, é só um jeito de viver nesse mundo de mágoa. Ele não é de nada. Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Nada, nada, nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Nada.
Ele não é de nada, só come marmelada. Ele não é de nada. Ele não é de nada. Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Ele não é de nada.
Muito obrigada. Thank you so much. Boca Melodia, Fernando Saci, Cissa Paz. Thank you so much for having us.
Jorge? Hi, everyone. My name is Natalia de Campos, and I'm here with Georgia, who's going to present one of the groups. We are from Defend Democracy in Brazil.
You can know more about our work in defenddemocracyinbrazil.org. We've been here since before the coup in 2016, and we organize a bunch of events and talks. And we're so thankful for all of you for coming and for People's Forum for always being a home to us and to all the Brazilian causes. We really appreciate it. Natalia is going to introduce our next speaker, who's really a special person.
We are really actually honored and humbled to be able to present Mumia Abu-Jamal. As you know, he's been a political prisoner for the last 30 years on death row, and then now in a life sentence since he's been taken out of the death row in 2011. Mumia was a member of the Black Party when he was 15, 16, and then a supporter of the Philadelphia's radical movement for Black liberation. And also he's a writer, a radio journalist, a very famous, and he's been able, even with his 30 years in solitary confinement, to keep his voice alive and be able to speak from the prison about all the issues that he defends, about his analysis of the world, but specifically about the Black liberation movement. And he has been following Lula's case from jail, and we have been honored with his speaking about it. This past Thursday, we got the recording and the People's Forum, especially for the People's Forum, and it was created for this event. So this is Mumia. And did you want to complete that?
I did. Thank you so much.
So he's specially recorded this for Lula.
Free Lula, Lula, Libre. His name is Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. But to millions of Brazilians, he's known simply as Lula, the former president of Brazil. In October 2018, he was poised to run again for the presidency, but to do so was opposed by the nation's rich, pale elites. A wave of anti-democratic neoliberalism has swept through elite circles in Brazil, and it has unleashed mass enmity against workers, the poor, Black folks, and LGBTQ people. In some ways, this was seen in the right-wing attack and assassination of Marielle Franco, a popular Black and gay city councilwoman from Rio de Janeiro. While her alleged killers were identified as two former cops, the questions of who sent them and why hovers over Rio. Lula, who, as a former union leader, had tremendous influence over labor unions, which in turn voted in his support and the Workers' Party. He's charged with alleged money transfers that were illegal, and his political base seemed to be the real target, especially when he planned to run for another term. Neoliberalism, despite how it sounds, is really the state's complete submission to the domination of finance capital. This Brazil, under an autocratic leader, Jair Bolsonaro, is open about his contempt for blacks, the poor, workers, and gay folk. And he's tried to bend the judiciary to his will, jailing Lula, denying his attempts to run for another term, and denying appeal bail. Supporters of Lula have demonstrated and marched for him, including the MST, known as the Landless Rural Workers Movement, and the collective known as the Free Lula Committee, which has demanded his immediate release. Internationally known scholars and intellectuals like Angela Davis, Noam Chomsky, Tariq Ali, and even Nobel Prize winners have joined the call to free Lula. I stand with Lula, a union man, a workers' man, and someone who stands for the dispossessed of Brazil. It is a struggle from the bottom to the top, a struggle for human rights over capitalist rights and property rights. Free Lula, from imprisoned nation, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ana Dias. I am one of the founders of the group Mulheres da Resistência no Exterior. Together, we helped more than 90 cities to organize protests against fascism and against Bolsonaro. Thank you. And we are still fighting. Now, our group idealizes and promotes debates, lectures, workshops, and events about political education and feminist causes. I am very honored to be here and to present the third panelist, the third panel of the night, which will address the reasons why Lula is in jail and why Bolsonaro is, unfortunately, our president. So, our panelists are Valesca Teixeira Martins, one of the lawyers of the former president Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, and Stanley Gasek, a North American labor lawyer who has followed the labor movement and labor politics in Brazil for 37 years. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ana Paula. I will be the moderator of this panel. I came to the U.S. recently from Bahia, one of the northeast, poorest state of our country, so I really know of my experience the changes that Lula has done there in terms of access to everything, water, education, and food. But I was a communications advisor for the PT government, so I could experience what was the change that Lula has done in terms of giving us the freedom of information law, that is the equivalent here in the US, and to the FOIA, and also the law of the transparency that allows us and obliges the governments to publish all costs in real time that are made by cities, states, and also the federal institution. And I was doing the website, and so all contracts was there. So during Lula government, it was the moment where Brazil has the most, like the biggest quantity of laws anti-corruption, and our president is now in jail, accused of corruption. So to talk about that, and not only the irony, but the unfairness of the situations we have, and I pass now the word for Valesca, and Stan here with us will do some comments, and that is, thank you for everyone to be here. Thank you, Valesca, for being with us.
Thank you. I'm hearing you. Yeah, now you're coming in. I'm sorry. Yes. So I'd like to thank you for inviting me to talk about what we have been living more than actually the legality of the case, and say that it's an honor to be with you from New York. How can we describe what this whole process has been? I would like to go back to 2014 when the car wash operation came out, and it was uncovered a bribery scheme within the Petrobras, which is the state-owned oil company in Brazil. Back in 2014, we had the elections, and that's when the media starts using threats against President Lula and President Dilma to throw suspicions whether he or she knew about the scandal or had any participation in the scandal during the elections of 2014. Back then, we started noticing that around 100, I think from 2014 and 2015, hundreds of magazines covers, hundreds of news articles came out, somehow throwing and hinting that Lula knew of a scandal here, knew of a scandal there, and it became massive. In a manner that everybody thought that so much suspicions were coming, arising, that he must have been guilty of something. And that's how this whole process begins. When the population is convinced that there must be something wrong, that's when, even though there was nothing, no indication, no evidence, nothing that would allow a precautionary measure against President Lula, by the partnership with the media, they actually were allowed to issue these search and seizure warrants against President Lula, against the Institute, against his children's houses. They were they bench warranted President Lula and took him to the airport in an arbitrary detention for 6 hours. That still remains not explained as to why he went to the airport. They unlawfully took materials from collaborators, from they even intercepted the lawyers. So it was back then that, you know, with that picture of Lula entering a police car to, you know, render to depose, that's when they knew that the population thought that they might find something. They searched, they broke his fiscal secrecy, they broke his banking secrecy, and trust me, they have a lot of surveillance and intelligence, but nothing from those actions, from his arbitrary actions against President Lula, nothing was found against him, nothing. And that's when you see the operation deviating to all of these, unreal theories. In July of 2016, we filed a communication before the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations. We understood that in Brazil, because of the partnership between the judiciary, parts of the judiciary, with the media, that Lula could not have a fair trial in Brazil. And our position, knowing all of the evidence, knowing all of the documents, is that if Lula had an impartial and fair trial, he undoubtedly would be found not guilty, would be found innocent by any court of law. So in July of 2016, we go to the Human Rights Committee, we explain all of these violations, gross violations of human rights, and that procedure is still being analyzed by the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations. And in September of 2016, we have another historic example of how Lula's human rights and how the presumption of his innocence is violated in most grossly and without any kind of equivalence in history. We have the PowerPoint. The PowerPoint portrayed Lula. I don't know if you ever saw the PowerPoint. And you have Lula in the center with lots of circles and with arrows pointing Lula towards Lula, trying to portray him as a criminal, as a commander of a big scheme of corruption that would perpetuate the PT, the Workers' Party in power, through massive corruption and stealing of public funds of public state-owned companies. That PowerPoint actually is not very new, because it was used by a prosecutor in the United States in a court of law, in a jury trial, and that same procedure was annulled by the Supreme Court in the United States, because they found that by the sole use of that PowerPoint induced the jury to a conviction of guilt, induced them to a conviction of violated the presumption of innocence of the defendant. So you can imagine when a prosecutor in Brazil of the Carlos operation calls a national and international press conference and exposes Lula without any kind of evidence, any shred of evidence, as being as the commander of a massive corruption scheme. From there on, they say that they have no evidence. They have a lot of they are pretty sure that they will prove that that Lula was guilty of something. You have to understand that that PowerPoint was the beginning of the entire procedure. In that PowerPoint, that accusation, they say that Lula commanded the scheme and that in return, he would gain the property of a beach apartment. Well, that is what the accusation says. Judge Sergio Moro, who is the presiding judge of the case, someone who is a political enemy of President Lula. He was presiding at the investigation of the case. And then from one moment to another, he admits the accusation against Lula, and Lula becomes a defendant in a procedure. Being a defendant in a criminal procedure is a penalty in itself. For someone like Lula to be investigated, to be a defendant, to constantly having to defend him, not only in procedures, but also in constant daily news coverage, is a penalty in itself. You have to understand how this whole procedure works. Well, during the trial, 73 witnesses were heard, deposed. Witnesses in Brazil have to tell the truth, as in the United States. And that's a very key element of the entire procedure. 73 witnesses were heard, all said that Lula was absolutely innocent. All of them said they were absolutely innocent. Back then, we had started realizing that that the there, well, we always said that the apartment was actually owned and always owned by the construction company. We proved also in the procedures, we had to prove his innocence. We had to prove that that apartment, the apartment that he's in jail for, could never be his, because OAS, the construction company, had sold the economic value of the apartment to a bank in Brazil. Therefore, if you wanted to purchase that apartment, you would have to pay for it and deposit the money in a specific bank account. So the accusation in the end is that he commanded the biggest scheme of bribery in the world to, in the future, be attributed an apartment that he would have to pay for. That's basically what the accusation and what the sentence says. And since they had absolutely no evidence of what, you know, of all of these theories that they were throwing, and they were illogical. They not only a shred of evidence, but they had no logic. They bring in, and that's how they manipulated the deposition of Léo Pinheiro. Léo Pinheiro was the president, the CEO of this construction company involved in the car operation, who owned in the beginning this this beach apartment. They throw him in jail for more than 2 years, suspicions start arising that he was being pressured and having psychological torture to say something about President Lula. That was out in the press, and Lula's defense even filed a motion before the Attorney General asking him to investigate and look into these suspicions that he was being tortured to somehow relate President Lula to these bogus charges. In the end, that was not admitted, of course. That's how it goes here in Brazil. And then we have his deposition, his famous deposition, Léo Pinheiro. If you're Brazilian, you remember when he comes to depose before Sergio Moro in the car wash operation. And he implicates Lula. He confirms the accusation. You have to understand that a co-defendant in Brazil is allowed to lie. It's different than the United States. He was a co-defendant in a deposition, in a criminal procedure, where he does not have to take the oath to say the truth. He may lie or be silent. That is how Sergio Moro and the prosecutors of the car wash operation used the deposition of Léo Pinheiro to convict President Lula. So out of these 73 witnesses, the massive documentation that proved Lula's innocence is in the files. The accusation was changed by Sergio Moro during the procedure. You have the defense's rights have been absolutely violated during the entire case. And by the end, Sergio Moro, in July of 2017, issues a conviction sentence overlooking all of the evidence of the files, which prove his Lula's innocence, and use Léo Pinheiro's word in a deposition where he could lie without proving anything to convict President Lula to 9.5 years in prison. It was a shocking conviction a political conviction, of course, because all of the files were completely ignored. And surprisingly enough, when we filed a motion to clarify, because the sentence was absolutely unclear and absolutely lacking logic, he says that he never said that Lula received any undue advantage from Petrobras. So as you see, it doesn't make the procedure is absolutely illogical and absolutely politically based. That's when we understand that and started to point out to the population, not only in Brazil but around the world, that Lula was being a victim of a phenomenon called lawfare, because the accusations had no materiality, absolutely no materiality, when in conjunction with the media, and the media created facts which had legal consequences and criminal consequences against President Lula. They turned into criminal cases, and with no logic, again, no logic, no evidence. There is a procedure that even goes to say that President Lula allowed a, they don't even say how he allowed a $7 billion loan from the bank in Brazil, public bank in Brazil, so that he would have in return three installments of his brother's health insurance paid. That makes no sense. It's absolutely illogical. It makes no sense. So even in the Atibaia country house, they say that because his wife's dog was bitten by a snake in that country house, that was evidence that he owned the country house. And there is a federal police report, I don't know how many pages, based on the veterinarian's opinion of the batting of the snake, that was his country house. So, and these are just a few examples of how this whole process works. They're absolutely baseless and meritless facts that come out in the media, and they start creating this idea that the accusations are actually have, you know, merits, and that's absolutely not true. So when you look into this phenomenon, and it works like warfare, it is the conjunction of law and warfare to create the word lawfare. And why is it lawfare? Because it works in the same dimensions of the war, except it is based on legal territory. You choose the jurisdiction where you want to fight this war, where you want to try your enemy, because you know that that jurisdiction is going to absolutely convict and work in a manner that will demonize and delegitimize your political enemy. The second dimension of war, which is the weapon that you use, is also carefully chosen in lawfare, because it is the law you're going to try your enemy on. And that happened with the Dilma impeachment, and it happens with President Lula. They chose the criminal organization law created in 2013. The third dimension, and the most important dimension, are the externalities, and how what I'm describing to you of this whole constant daily news on something coming out, might coming out, will come out, might, all of these news that create a psychological war and create this perception in the population that Lula is guilty of something, that is how they are allowed to convict on this meritless, absurd, no logic charges. And this is how the whole process works with all of the procedures. And you're going to have to take my word on that, because there are so many, and I could discuss them all with you. That would take 3 days, but I know it's late here and there. But this is how the lawfare works. So it's the abuse and misuse of the law to delegitimize, to demonize a political enemy. And I was listening to your prior panel, and someone asked you, Stanley, about all of these corruption charges. that, you know, that came out against him. And that's exactly the feeling that they want to portray, that there are so many corruption charges that he must be guilty of something. And I can tell you that there's absolutely no evidence. 5 years of investigations, 5 years, nationally, internationally, cooperation with DOJ, cooperation with Swiss authorities, cooperation with any authorities of the entire world, and they haven't found one dime, one cent that, you know, that has been illegally earned by President Lula. One cent. What? Nothing. One note, one letter, nothing. Nope. There's no evidence of any wrongdoing from President Lula while he was in presidency or presidency or out of presidency or out of office. So what we have witnessed and realized and analyzed throughout the procedure is that there was an enemy, you know, thinking of how to work this out. And this is what has been proven throughout the last week, with with all of the charges with all of the suspicion that has come out regarding the DOJ agreement, regarding the SEC agreement, and now regarding the class action with investors in the United States. And I think that's the key aspect that should be also, from this point of the defense, that should be analyzed and discussed. And I know my time is up. There's so many aspects that should be brought to your attention. But this procedure, making it very short, this is what it is: baseless, meritless, meritless loss, suspicions, meritless charges to demonize a political enemy. That's basically it.
So, thank you, Valeska. We still have a little bit of time. I would like to see if we can comment. You could comment on recently aspects of the trail, like what is happening right now. We know that the case of the apartment would be like gone to Supreme. It was postponed. So for us to understand a little bit in what moment we are in terms of the case. And since you mentioned the involvement of the US, like the Justice Department, we also know that we have recently access to documents that shows the involvement of the Lava Jato tax force into transferring money directly, the US, the companies Petrobras and Odebrecht being forced to pay them some money, and that is being questioned, and also the involvement far before that, 2009, Sergio Moro was one of the trained judges by the US Department in how to get evidences, and 2015 also some more proofs. And so trying, since we have Stan here, and they're also part of trying to tell us how these arrangements are happening, because the U.S. should not be involved since Lula has no bank account in the U.S. for them to be like worried in this case. So tell us what is happening now, a little bit of these involvements into the contracts of Lima.
15, also some more proofs. So trying, since we have
technical problem, hold on. I don't know if I heard you correctly, because we had a bad connection. According to Brazilian legislation and constitution, no one may be imprisoned prior to a final unappealable decision. So the constitution says that that everybody should be presumed innocent until a final unappealable decision. And the penal code of the criminal code of Brazil says that nobody can be imprisoned prior to a final unappealable decision. There is no room for any interpretation other than what the law literally states. So what happens is the car wash operation had to basically, what they were fighting is that they wanted possible plea bargainers to feel more threatened into enter into plea bargain agreements. That would mean confirming the plea bargain, the accusations that the prosecutors made. So they started this whole movement where they say that everybody should be imprisoned, that people in Brazil should be imprisoned after an appellate court decision, which is illegal and unlawful and could not be even changed by Congress because it is what we call a cláusula pétrea. It is what was a stone, like a stone clause within our constitution that is not allowed to be changed unless a new constitution, Congress, and then can help me, Stanley, with this translation. But we, you know, without a new constituinte power, that may not be changed. So there is no room for interpretation there. When President Lula was convicted in 2017, it became, well, since it's a political procedure, they started to threaten to imprison him after the appellate court. We filed a preventive habeas corpus after the appellate courts confirmed the Sergio Moro's decision, and that preventive habeas corpus was ruled in the merits. It's very important to remember, in the merits, we won because Rosa Weber was very clear and said that she understood that nobody could be imprisoned after an appellate court decision. But in the technicality, she did not recognize the habeas corpus. So that is how President Lula was imprisoned. And a day prior to that habeas corpus decision, the general, Vilas Boas, tweeted threatening the Supreme Court. That is something that we also take to the United Nations Human Rights Committee. This undue pressure and intervention of the military, of the army of Brazil in Supreme Court decisions. After that period, after that event, Lula was illegally and abusively and arbitrarily incarcerated, and it's been a year now. Three different actions for constitutionality have been filed: ADC 43, ADC 44, and ADC 54. If you remember, by December of last year, the rapporteur of these three cases issued a preliminary injunction stating that they all detainees who were held based on the understanding that you could be in jail after the appellate court, they all should be released because of irreparable harm. I mean, who can return months and months of prison? We have a system here. We have the worst prisons, I think, perhaps in the world. We are fighting to get the first place, but it is a very troubling incarceration system. So he issued that decision by December of last year, and illegally the Supreme Court president suspended it, revoked it. So by next week, we're supposed to have the hearing on the merits of these three cases, and it was delayed once more because, of course, Lula is a problem that the judiciary has to solve. They know he's innocent. I'm absolutely sure that they know he's innocent. They know that they've incarcerated him for a year, most arbitrarily. But he's a problem. After 5 years of this whole spectacle in the media, nationally and internationally, the judiciary has to give a response they become co-responsible for the whole illegality against him, for the gross violations of his human rights. So I think now they are trying to work away around their omission throughout this, you know, these past 5 years. And to incarcerate Lula, to solve Lula's problems, 170,000 people have been illegally incarcerated. That's, you know, everybody, not only President Lula is a human being, but all of these other 170,000 people, they're also suffering because of this this lie that was created by the coercion operation against Lula. So that is absolutely unthinkable. And as to the DOJ, back in 2016, while we were hearing and deposing all of the witnesses of the Beach Apartment case, we found out that they were these plea bargainers, the first the five plea bargainers, initial plea bargainers, the corruption center of the center of corruption within Petrobras. They were giving depositions to the DOJ, Department of Justice of the United States, in a parallel case. We tried to obtain copies of these depositions. Judge Sergio Moro, always not acting as the bargainer's lawyer, did not allow any of these depositions, any of their contents, to be shared with the Lula's defense. And in that point, you have to understand that in Brazil, we do not have discovery. We do not have Brady principles. It's a very difficult system to litigate in or to defend one in without all of these procedural rules that would, give more justice to defendants in Brazil. So we tried to obtain copies of those depositions. We've always known that there was illegal exchange of evidence between the prosecutors in Brazil and the prosecutors of the Department of Justice. And then last year, a video came out of a prosecutor, Kenneth Blanco, admitting that they were informally exchanging evidence with the prosecutors in Brazil. Judge McFadden, I think now he's a judge, he was a prosecutor then, he came to Brazil, he met with Janot, who was the chief prosecutor of the country, and said that they informally exchanged information on a daily basis, which is illegal according to our constitution, according to our laws. And in September of last year, we were surprised with a non-prosecution agreement between Petrobras and the Department of Justice. In that non-prosecution agreement, they stated a fine of $680 million, out of which 80% was to be sent to Brazil, to Brazilian authorities. That's what the agreement said. Surprisingly enough, what they did is the car wash operation in Curitiba, who does not represent Brazilian authorities, entered into an agreement with Petrobras and 2.5 billion reais in January, which is the equivalent of 600 and something amount, millions of dollars, were deposited in a bank account that was run by the judge of the car wash operation. They sealed that procedure. That procedure was absolutely sealed. Nobody had any access to the terms of that understanding between Petrobras and the prosecutors. And now the surprising fact is that money was deposited by January 31st. And the second conviction against Lula came out 5 days after the money was deposited in before the Curitiba court.
Okay, Valeska, I would sorry for interrupting you. I needed to interrupt because of our time. Yes, unfortunately, it's like we don't have enough time to that. And I just wanted to see if we can have at least some few words from Stan. And I'm so sorry, to reduce the time of the Q&A for two. So I'm so sorry because we'd love to hear, but since Stan is here, just like see if you can complement something, and we have to open for some questions, so maybe we can continue that with the questions of the public.
Boa noite, doctora. This is your law student, Stanley Gasek. I want to say, actually, just a word of appreciation to make this public, that actually the information, the education that you, Cristiano Martins, and really the whole Lula team, defense team, have been able to impart that information and education you've been able to impart to U.S. jurists, U.S. lawyers, U.S. labor lawyers like myself, and to the judicial community has been worldwide that want real justice has been invaluable. And I've received an invaluable education. I'll just, because the time is very short, I'm just going to make a few inflections on what you've said, some points of emphasis, and maybe ask for maybe some a little bit further clarification in a very abbreviated way. Given your expression about lawfare, I think is extremely important. Actually, in one of your earlier presentations, you said that it's the abuse and the misuse of the law in a violent manner to conduct political persecution. So I think that this is a very, very important truth, and a very, very important truth that Lula is a political prisoner and that he is innocent. I think that this, I think you've reinforced that message extremely well. I think the statement that you made, again, we're looking at the anniversary now of habeas corpus being denied to Lula and his being sent to prison. And you mentioned, and I think this is very, very critical, about how the Brazilian judiciary, unfortunately, we want to respect rule of law, but unfortunately everything has become so politicized. And this Twitter message that went out, this message that went out from the general on the eve of the review of the STF, basically saying, we will not tolerate impunity. Obviously was actually, that actually woke up even Amnesty International they and the human rights community had to say, this is reaching a point of actually violating all international standards of due process and justice before the law. But I think what we're looking at this anniversary of this very unjust denial of habeas corpus to Lula at that point actually shows what pressure can do. And we want to respect rule of law, the sanctity of the Brazilian judicial system. At the same time, it has been subject to political pressures. And I just will say, I think we're going to be discussing this in the next panel, is now the issue is organizing in the United States and globally to develop nonviolent, entirely legal pressure, but to send a message also to the system. I think what you've also brought up tonight, Valeska, is very important. I've, in learning from you, following the process, I've actually said in a number of my talks here, and I actually said it tonight, that actually, if the Brazilian constitutional, Brazilian law were faithfully followed, Lula would be found innocent, and Lula would have been able to run. And I wonder, again, I know our time is brief, but one of the false narratives, unfortunately, that dominated the press, and particularly the U.S. press, was that, well, Lula was ineligible because that's what Brazilian electoral law said. Yes, there was the clean ficha limpa, the clean ballot or the clean slate law, which, as you know, was ironically passed under the Lula administration in 2010, and that this is why, this is the basis of why he should not be permitted to run. I wondered if you might talk about that a little bit. One other point I wanted to make before we forget it, and talk about total unequal treatment to show how Lula is being persecuted is the very fact that even though thousands of criminal defendants and convicts are given leave in due time to actually attend the funerals of their family and their loved ones. This was denied to Lula with regard to his eldest brother, and I wondered if you would might comment on that. There's so much that we can discuss. I know the legal landscape is so complex, but I do think in terms of the legal theories, the legal approach, the legal strategy, as you know very well, and as you're moving forward on that front with your excellent team with regard to the International Law Forum, and namely the UN Committee on Human Rights, wondered if perhaps you might comment a bit about where we are there. Finally, plea bargaining means something here. It has some probative value here in the United States. But I do think that there's also a lot of misunderstanding of what plea bargaining means with regard to the evidentiary system in Brazil, which I think would be very, very useful to know. We can go on with the arguments, but I just want to, in terms of my commentary, I think you've reinforced the point. I just would want to make a point in my commentary that if Brazilian constitution, if Brazilian law were followed, and obviously if international law were followed, because you know very well the UN Committee on Human Rights said his rights under the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights are irreparably harmed unless he is allowed to run. And I'll make this point, as you know very, very well, in international law, even though in this case there's no blue helmets to enforce it, is that when a state member, when a country ratifies a convention or a treaty, it is binding in terms of international law. Therefore, the Brazilian authorities should have respected what the conclusion was of the UN committee with regard to Lula being allowed to be a candidate. But you may want to comment a bit as well as the next phase of the UN review with regard to Lula. But thanks again for great enlightenment. I think the important point is that if the law were really respected, Lula would be with us. He would have been he would have participated in the elections. He would have won. And now we have to keep on fighting. Thank you.
Sorry. So just like Valesca, we are really sorry. I'm really sorry, Stan. So we wanted to thank you, and we should have more time to that discussion that is so important. I would suggest that now we try to adapt, like to include Stan as one of the questions for the Q&A and open for the public. So we'll have like two questions and we'll be discussing as an entire block. So you can answer Stan's and also the questions for the public. So questions?
E de novo, agora em português. Se alguém quiser falar em português, eu traduzo para inglês, tá?
So do we have... And I would ask you to be brief in your questions, please.
Valeska, is one of the things that, as you mentioned, about the massive corruption that he was charged for, I don't know if it's a sort of we can charge Bolsonaro for massive torture. I don't know if the Brazilian law allows to do that, because a torture to Lula is a massive torture for all the Brazilian people that wants him out and wants him to run again. That is my question.
Sorry, we're just gonna do a second one and then she'll respond there.
I think for the public in the United States, it's extremely important to understand the role of the DOJ in this process. Not that many people know that in this particular, DOJ has a secretary inside of the department that is to deal with corruptions in order, kind of the World Bank and IMF, in order to make the world bend towards whatever multinationals from the United States wants to be doing. So it's literally if a government gives contracts to the national companies or companies from that country, they enter with this type of accusation so they can get the contracts or whatever they want from themselves. I want to talk more about this because this case with Brazil and Petrobras and Aldebrecht in DOJ history was the fastest one ever with the highest amount of money. So they really rushed this to make sure that whoever was going to receive the money was receiving the money. On the top of that, they also inserted people. So I'm not going to talk too much about that. I'm going to let Valeska talk more, because for the American people or the Brazilians who live here in the United States like myself, it's extremely important to understand the role of the United States government in this process and the DOJ, so we can act on that as well.
And I'm sorry, Valeska, to ask you to be also brief because of the time.
I'd just like to comment very shortly that, yes, Stan, everybody in Brazil says that Lula is not above the law, and we agree. We just, actually, he's not beneath the law. That's what people want him to be, and that's what we will not stand for. That's the issue. So in terms of, if I'm not mistaken, plea bargain in Brazil states that, according to a plea bargain law, plea bargainers must say the truth and give evidence of what they're saying. What has been happening in Brazil is that plea bargainers are stating and confirming the accusation without giving any evidence, and then they get a second plea bargainer to confirm that accusation, so they say that that's evidence enough. Well, that's not. And that's being misused. That's a misuse of our plea bargainer in Brazil. But Judge Moro goes even further. What he does is he's using co-defendants to convict people in their procedures because they just simply may lie. It doesn't matter whether they tell the truth or they give evidence of what they're saying. So we have Leo Pinheiro and we have Palocci, for that matter, who took out notes that, you know, he had to remember as he was following a script in his deposition. According to, and I have to say about Lula's prison conditions, Lula is incarcerated in a cell, not having access, he cannot give interviews. He is now only allowed half an hour with the lawyers, with the attorneys. He may not make phone calls. He's inaccessible, practically. And that is something that those conditions, practically solitary confinement, is something that is also being constantly reported to the United Nations as that procedure progresses. In terms of his political rights, then, we filed the communication back in 2016 denouncing gross violation of his human rights, four grave violations, a presumption of innocence, and illegal interference with his privacy because of the leaking of his phone calls, including his wife's phone calls, late wife's with his son, which is had nothing to do with the procedure whatsoever. That was intentionally done to demonize Lula. The arbitrary incarceration in the airport for 6 hours. That was not provided for by our law or constitution. Also now, Article 25, which is related to his political rights, have been admitted in that procedure. And from the, and in the same decision from May 2018, they admit Article 25, and they put a kind of a, put a stay on the entire procedures against him, so it does not interfere with the future judgment of the merits of the case before the United Nations. Brazil, let's remember, not only ratified the pact, but it entered into the optional protocol, which is optional only in the name. It means that it's optional when you enter into, but then when you ratify that agreement, and that was ratified in 2009, it means you accept the jurisdiction of the United States, the United Nations Human Rights Court. It's a Valeska. Court, and it's a binding decision.
Valeska, I'm so sorry. It's a, yeah, I'm very sorry. We still have Breno Altman waiting for us. He's online. He's the next program of our panel. I'm very sorry for all the people that also was making questions. I really want to thank you in name of the... whole group, like the group that are here, the People's Forum as well. Thank you, Stem, for again being with us. and we have to keep going with the procedure. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lula livre, a luta continua. And for us, Lula livre!
Hi, everyone. Thank you for your patience. We have an excellent journalist from Brazil coming up. We're just trying to connect with him. I know we're running a little late, but we should have him on in a few minutes. And after that, we'll have an amazing DJ, DJ Greg Cass, who is already here, and we'll finally get to dance and enjoy ourselves.
Hi, everyone. My name is Uli, and I'm a member of the group Brado, that stands for Brazilian Resistance Against Democracy Overthrow. We are founded in 2016 when Brazil's democracy was threatened by the parliamentary coup d'etat that deposed the president Dilma Rousseff. Since then, we have fought for social justice, human rights, and for the restoration of our democracy, which is strongly believe that cannot be achieved without the working class and also without the greatest leader of all time in Brazil, that is Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva. To talk about the Lula Livre campaign and the significance of international efforts, I introduce you to our next guest. He's a journalist, the founder and director of the Opera Mundi website, a collaborator for several publications in Brazil and abroad as a reporter and analyst of international issues. He's also the communications director of the Lula Livre campaign. Please help me welcome Breno Altman.
Boa noite a todos os amigos e companheiros. First of all, I would like to say that it's an honor for me to be present, even virtually, in a so important meeting. I'd like to thank you for hosting this teaching and for inviting me to speak on behalf of a Free Lula campaign. We are deeply grateful to the American unions, collectives, and parties that are joining today to create the USA Free Lula Committee. I'll try not to be much boring. And since the beginning, I apologize if my speech is from time to time interrupted by annoying coughs. I'm in the middle of an asthma attack. Sorry for that. We have been organizing Free Lula campaign after presidential elections. Since January, besides the International Committee led by Mr. Celso Amorim, former Minister of Foreign Affairs under President Lula, we have created an executive structure to build a multi-party and multi-social united front. More than 3 months of real hard work. On March 16th, we performed the first national meeting with campaign organizers, with 1,200 activists taking part from almost all Brazilian states. Since then, a lot of new committees, maybe hundreds, have been created. And from April 7th to 10th, with important warming up like yours, is happening the first Free Lula International Rally in more than 200 cities across the world. These are just the first steps. The most important cells of this movement are the national and international committees. People like you, coming from different sectors and political experience, are our best weapons to inform and to convince about our cause, mobilizing for Lula's freedom across the world. We have started a communication campaign. We have spots and pamphlets. Also very capable and experienced lawyers. You have just listened to Valeska, is a very competent lawyer. Many relevant political and social leaders are engaged, but nothing, I repeat, nothing is more useful than building thousands and thousands of committees like the one you are founding tonight. Through this horizontal movement, it's possible to boost rallies, lobbies, and manifestos. It's possible to pressure Brazilian government and world institutions. It's possible to denounce the lawfare and to demand freedom and justice for Lula. Our struggle, we know, you know, is very hard. We need all support available. Like in the past, as was to fight for Mandela, the victory depends on clarifying and putting thousands, hundreds of thousands in movement. The persecution and legal manipulation against Lula are part of a political escalation to put down Brazilian democracy. The beginning was 5 years ago, after Dilma Rousseff was elected. Conservative parties backed by economic groups, media monopolies, and foreign governments joined with their partners in the legal system, promoted a political crisis to overthrow the constitutional president. They were triumphant in 2016 when Dilma was impeached. a new and usurper government was settled to implement an ultra-liberal agenda, liberal in our way of thinking, not yours in the United States. But that was not enough at all. Lula was the favored candidate in all elector surveys that inquire about 2018 poll. And the only way to guarantee a right-wing triumph was to put the former president out of the game. That's happened. Exactly a year ago, Lula has been in prison without crimes and without proofs after being condemned by Sergio Moro, current Bolsonaro's Minister of Justice. The man who condemned Lula and put him out of the game is now the Minister of Justice of the man who was benefited by the decision of this judge. An essential role in this setting had Brazilian press, as in all the moments of our history. Only four groups control in my country, in our country, because I know there are many Brazilians watching to my words. Only four groups control in my country over 70% of everything we listen, read, or watch to. We are talking about media empires like Globo. And these groups have been working full-time to criminalize Lula, the Workers' Party, the Progressive Social Movement, and the rest of leftist parties. For our ruling classes, Lula must be in jail forever. In order to finally destroy our constitution and democratic rights, in order to privatize our mineral resources and reduce wages, in order to eliminate social achievements and public service, in order to make Brazil a new colonial country. That's the reason we can undoubtedly affirm that a strike for Lula's freedom is a question of justice. He is innocent. But it's also, and above all, to strike for Brazilian democracy. You may help us a lot, taking the truth to the press, petitioning your parliament, organizing activities inside colleges and unions, rallying in front of Brazilian embassy, publicizing opinion formers for Lula inside the United States and also outside. Only political pressure is able to obtain a new and fair judgment for Lula, eventually imposed by some international decision. That's our target, I repeat, clarify, mobilize. It's going to be a long and winding road, as George Harrison wrote once upon a time. You know what to do better than us. I remember how the people of the United States fought for Sacco and Vanzetti, the Rosenberg couple, the Hollywood Ten, Mumia Abu-Jamal, Nelson Mandela, and so many civil rights activists. Popular struggle inside and outside our borders is able to rewrite the history. And that's our issue this evening and in this campaign. As say the famous song, "We Shall Overcome." Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Breno. I know it's very late in Brazil, so thank you for being with us at such a late hour. Thank you.
It was incredible. I was able to say my words without coughing, almost a year.
Congratulations. Thank you for to everyone for coming to this event and for being here, and to Free Lula, being here for Lula at such a late hour. I have one more announcement before we start dancing and and enjoying ourselves. It's about the launch of the U.S. Lula Libre Committee. Like Breno said, there are Lula Libre committees all over the world. There's been a launch of a U.S. Lula Libre Committee. Some of the people of the organizations are already present here, so I want to acknowledge them. The U.S. Network for Democracy in Brazil, Defend Democracy in Brazil, Party for Socialism and Liberation, United Steelworkers, Global Strategies, Colectivo Boston Contra o Golpe, Colectivo Humanas, Colectivo Alerta, Brazilian Expat for Democracy Washington, Western Mass Colectivo Pela Democracia no Brasil, pardon my pronunciation, please, National People's Resistance Front, Honduras, and they have their first action for Lula tomorrow at 2 p.m. So if you can join it, please do. And last but not least, we want to hear from the man himself, the most popular president in Brazil, the amazing Lula. So we're gonna hear from his last speech, and then we're gonna be able to enjoy the amazing music from Greg Cass. Thank you so much for coming.
Pois bem, nós agora estamos num trabalho delicado. Eu também vivo um momento de maior indignação que o ser humano.
Não é fácil.
Pois bem, o que sofre
nós agora estamos num trabalho família. Delicado.
Não é fácil que
eu talvez viva um momento de maior indignação
não
que
é
o ser humano.
Não é fácil o que sofreu
não
a Marisa.
É fácil.
E eu
o
quero
que sofre a minha família.
A antecipação é fácil da
que
morte
da Marisa.
Os meus filhos.
Foi a safadeza.
Não é fácil
e a sacanagem
o que sofreu
que
a Marisa
e o Ministério
e eu quero dizer contra ela.
Que
a antecipação
da morte da Marisa.
Porque essa
foi
gente,
a safadeza
eu acho que não tem filho,
e a saca
eu acho que não tem alma e não tem noção do que sente uma mãe ou um pai quando vê um filho massacrado, quando vê um filho sendo atacado. E eu então, companheiros, resolvi levantar a cabeça. Não pense que eu sou contra a Lava Jato, não. A Lava Jato, se pegar bandido, tem que pegar bandido mesmo que roubou e prender. Todos nós queremos isso. Todos nós, a vida inteira, dizíamos, só prende pobre, não prende rico. Todos nós dizíamos. E eu quero que continue prendendo rico. Eu quero. Agora, qual é o problema? É que você não pode fazer julgamento subordinado à imprensa. Quem quiser votar com base na opinião pública, largue a toga e vá ser candidato a deputado. Escolha um partido político e vá ser candidato. Ora, a toga, ela é um emprego vitalício. O cidadão tem que votar apenas com base nos autos do processo. O juiz tem que ter, diferentemente de nós, a cabeça mais fria, mais responsabilidade de fazer acusação ou de condenar. O Ministério Público é uma instituição muito forte. Por isso, esses meninos que entram muito novo, fazem um curso de direito, depois faz 3 anos de concurso, porque o pai pode pagar. Esses meninos precisavam conhecer um pouco da vida, conhecer um pouco de política para fazer o que eles fazem na sociedade brasileira. Tem uma coisa chamada responsabilidade. Você não pode condenar a pessoa pela imprensa para depois você julgá-la. Vocês estão lembrados que quando eu fui prestar depoimento lá em Curitiba, Eu disse pro Moro, você não tem condições de me absolver, porque a Globo está exigindo que você me condene e você vai me condenar. Que eu quero fazer a transferência de responsabilidade. Eles acham que tudo que acontece nesse país acontece por minha causa. O que é que eu quero transferir de responsabilidade? O que eu tenho dito todo dia. Eles não sabem. Eles não sabem que o problema desse país não chama-se Lula. O problema desse país chama-se vocês, a consciência do povo, o Partido dos Trabalhadores, o PCdoB, o MST, o MTST. Eles sabem que tem muita gente. E eu tenho dito todo o discurso. Não adiantam tentar evitar que eu ande por esse país, porque tem milhões e milhões de Lula, de Bolo, de Manuela, de Dilma Rousseff para andar por mim. Não adianta tentar acabar, sabe, com as minhas ideias. Elas já estão pairando no ar e não tem como prendê-las. Não adianta tentar parar o meu sonho, porque quando eu parar de sonhar, eu sonharei pela cabeça de vocês e pelo sono de vocês. Não adianta achar que tudo vai parar o dia que o Lula tiver infarte. É bobagem, porque o meu coração baterá pelo coração de vocês, e são milhões de corações. Não adianta eles acharem que vão fazer com que eu pare. Eu não pararei porque eu não sou mais um ser humano. Eu sou uma ideia. Uma ideia misturada com a ideia de vocês. E eu tenho certeza que companheiros como Sem Terra, MTST, os companheiros da CUT, do movimento sindical, sabem. E essa é uma prova. Essa é uma prova. Eu vou cumprir o mandato. E vocês vão ter que se transformar, cada um de vocês. Vocês não vão mais chamar Chiquinha, Joãozinho, Zezinho, Albertinho. Todos vocês daqui para frente vão virar Lula e vão andar por esse país fazendo o que você tem que fazer. E é todo dia, é todo dia. Eles têm que saber que a morte de um combatente não para a revolução. Eles têm que saber. Eles têm que saber que nós vamos fazer definitivamente uma regulação dos meios de comunicação para que o povo não seja vítima das mentiras todo santo dia. Eu vou terminar com uma frase que eu peguei em 1982 numa menina de 10 anos em Catanduva, que eu não sei quem é. E essa frase não tem autor. A frase dizia: os poderosos podem matar uma, duas ou três rosas, mas jamais conseguirão deter a chegada da primavera. E a nossa luta é em busca da primavera. Eles têm que saber que nós queremos mais casa, nós queremos mais escola, nós queremos menos mortalidade. Nós não queremos repetir a barbaridade que fizeram com a Marielle no Rio de Janeiro. Nós não queremos repetir a barbaridade que fazem com meninos negros na periferia desse país. Nós não queremos mais que volte a desnutrição, a mortalidade por desnutrição desse país. Nós não queremos mais que um jovem não tenha esperança de entrar na universidade. Eles não queriam que a juventude brasileira estudasse. E falaram que custava muito fazer escola. É se perguntar quanto custou não fazer há 50 anos atrás. Então eu quero que vocês saibam que eu tenho orgulho, profundo orgulho, de ter sido o único presidente da República sem ter um diploma universitário, mas sou o presidente da República que mais fiz universidade na história desse país, para mostrar para esta gente que não confunda inteligência com quantidade de anos na escolaridade. Isso não é inteligência, é conhecimento. Inteligência é quando você sabe tomar decisão. Inteligência é quando você tem lado. Inteligência é quando você não tem medo de discutir com os companheiros aquilo que é prioridade. E a prioridade desse país é garantir que esse país volte a ter cidadania. Não vão vender a Petrobras. Vamos fazer uma nova constituinte. Vamos revogar a lei do petróleo que eles estão fazendo. Não vamos deixar vender o BNDES. Não vamos deixar vender a Caixa Econômica. Não vamos deixar destruir o Banco do Brasil. E vamos fortalecer a agricultura familiar, que é responsável por 70% do alimento que nós comemos nesse país. É com essa crença, companheiros, de cabeça erguida, como eu estou falando com vocês, que eu quero chegar lá e falar para o delegado, estou à sua disposição. E a história, daqui a alguns dias, vai provar que quem cometeu o crime foi o delegado que me acusou, foi o juiz que me julgou e foi o Ministério Público que foi leviano comigo. Por isso, companheiros, eu não tenho lugar no meu coração para todo mundo. Mas eu quero que vocês saibam, se tem uma coisa que eu aprendi a gostar nesse mundo, é da minha relação com o povo. Quando eu era presidente, eu dizia, eu vou votar para onde eu vim. E eu sei quem são meus amigos eternos e quem são os amigos eventuais. E quem está comigo é aqueles companheiros que eram meus amigos antes de eu ser presidente da República. É aqueles que têm coragem de invadir um terreno para fazer casa. É aqueles que têm coragem de fazer uma greve contra a Previdência. É aqueles que têm coragem de fazer, sabe, uma greve ou ocupar um campo para fazer uma fazenda produtiva. É aqueles que, na verdade, precisam do Estado. Então, companheiros, eu vou dizer uma coisa a vocês. Vocês vão perceber que eu sairei dessa maior, mais forte, mais verdadeiro e inocente, porque eu quero provar que eles é que cometeram um crime político de perseguir um homem que tem 50 anos de história política. E por isso eu sou muito grato. Eu não tenho como pagar a gratidão, o carinho e o respeito que vocês têm dedicado por mim nesses tantos anos. Eu vou de cabeça erguida e vou sair de peito estufado de lá, porque vou provar a minha inocência. Um abraço, companheiros. Obrigado, mas muito obrigado a todos vocês pelo que vocês me ajudaram. Um beijo, querido. Muito obrigado.
Apesar de você, amanhã há de ser outro dia.
Eu pergunto a você, onde vai se esconder da enorme euforia? Como vai proibir, quando o galo insistir em cantar? Sem parar. Quando chegar o momento, esse meu sofrimento, vou cobrar com juros, juro. Todo esse amor reprimido, esse grito contido, este samba no escuro. Você que inventou a tristeza, ora tem a fineza de desinventar. Você vai pagar e é dobrado cada lágrima rolada nesse meu penar.
já está fora das suas mãos.